718-715-4411. Choice Radio Network.
Choice Radio. Your life. Your salvation. Your choice. Choice Radio.
If Choice Radio is a blessing and an inspiration to you, write us at Choice Gospel Network, P.O. Box 30016, Brooklyn, New York, 11203.
Nothing can separate.
Choice Radio. Your life. Your salvation. Your choice. Choice Radio.
Precious Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Jesus, for bringing us here again to worship your name and to lift you up, Almighty Father. Father, we are free today. We are free to praise you. We are free to call on your name, Almighty God. And for this, we give you thanks. I present this broadcast before you, Almighty God. And be our strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Welcome to the prophetic dimension. This is Brother Andrew Edwards, and we're just giving God praise. And we thank God for being on the radio one more time. Last week we were away, but God has saw fit to bring us back here again. Stay with us.
Begin to realize that there is nothing which is so serious as to be without the presence of God. Do you get its full force? God was sending them to the promised land. God was saying, go up. I've promised you the land of Canaan. I'm going to give it you. You shall go to the land flowing with milk and honey. I'll send my angel before you to destroy these enemies, these Amorites, these Hittites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hivites, and Jebusites. Go along. Go up to your promised land. I've brought you out of the captivity of Egypt. I'm sending you on. Go ahead. Lead them, Moses. I'll send an angel with you. And the people said, no. If you're not coming with us, we don't want to go. Now that's the essence of spiritual understanding. And that's the thing, my dear friends, that you and I have got to come to. You see, here were a people who suddenly awakened, came to this tremendous, profound realization that to be given every other blessing is of no value if God is doing it. What's the value of Canaan? What's the value of milk and honey? What's the value of having possessions? If you are not with us, they saw that the realization of the presence of God, having his fellowship and company, was infinitely more important than everything else. Need I apply this to the church today? You can have successes over your enemies, you know. Without this great realization of God in the midst. Oh yes. There are angels who can do that for us. Destroy certain of our enemies. Take us to the land. We're in Canaan. We've got the milk and honey. Yes, everything seems to be all right. There's an appalling verse in Psalm 106 where we are told to the children of Israel, God granted them their requests but sent leanness into their soul. You can have an outward prosperity and affluence. The church may seem to be doing remarkably well. Good finances, good figures, successes, conversions, enemies defeated, everything going well. And the newspapers report it. The Christian newspapers report it. It all seems to be marvelous. But the appalling question I ask is this. Is God in the midst? Is he really amongst us? Are we aware, as we should be, of his glorious presence? That's the thing that got these people.
Jesus at the center of it all.
Hallelujah.
Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end,
it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, nothing else matters.
Glory to God.
Jesus be the center. Jesus. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens. Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart.
Beethoven composed music. Sweep streets like Shakespeare wrote poetry. Sweep streets so well that all the host of heaven and earth will have to pause and say, here lived a great street sweeper who swept his job well. If you can't be a pine on the top of a hill, be a scrub in the valley, but be the best little scrub on the side of the rill. Be a bush if you can't be a tree. If you can't be a highway, just be a trail. If you can't be the sun, be a star. It isn't by size that you win or you fail. Be the best of whatever you are. And when you do this, you've mastered the length of life. This onward push to the end of self-fulfillment is the end of a person's life. Now, don't stop here, though. You know, a lot of people get no further in life than the length. They develop their inner powers. They do their jobs well. Do you know they try to live as if nobody else lives in the world but themselves? And they use everybody as mere tools to get to where they are going. They don't love anybody but themselves. And the only kind of love that they really have for other people is utilitarian love. You know, they just love people that they can use. A lot of people never get beyond the first dimension of life. They use other people as mere steps to which or by which they can climb to their goals and their ambitions. These people don't work out well in life. They may go for a while. They may think they're making it all right. But there is a law. They call it the law of gravitation in the physical universe.
Jesus, it works. It's final.
It's inexorable.
From beginning to the end, it
will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center, and everything revolves around you. Jesus, you. Jesus, be the center of my.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, be the center of my life.
Well, I was called to
from
a little
beginning to the end,
down in Montgomery, Alabama.
It will always be, it's always been you, Jesus.
Now I started preaching there. Things Jesus were going well in that church. It was a marvelous experience.
My Lord.
But one day, a year later, a lady by the name of Rosa Parks decided that she wasn't going to take it any longer. She stayed on a bus seat. And you may not remember it because it's way back now, several years, but it was the beginning of a movement where 50,000 black men and women refused absolutely to ride the city buses, and we walked together for 381 days.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
That's what we got to learn in the North. The Negroes have to learn to stick together. We stuck together. We sent out the call. No Negro rode the buses. It was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen in my life. And the people of Montgomery asked me to serve as the spokesman. And as the president of the new organization, the Montgomery Improvement Association, that came into being to lead the boycott, I couldn't say no. And then we started our struggle together. Things were going well for the first few days, but then, about 10 or 15 days later, after the white people in Montgomery knew that we meant business, they started doing some nasty things. They started making nasty telephone calls, and it came to the point that some days more than 40 telephone calls would come in threatening my life, the life of my family, the life of my children. I took it for a while in a strong manner, but I never will forget one night very late. It was around midnight, and you can have some strange experiences at midnight. I had been out meeting with the steering committee all that night. And I came home. My wife was in the bed, and I immediately crawled into bed to get some rest, to get up early the next morning. And immediately,
hallelujah.
You are the hope of broken hearts. You overcame the grave to save humanity.
Sing it. Grow up in the house.
Jesus says, my life.
I heard these things before, but for some reason that night it got to me. I turned over and I tried to go to sleep, but I couldn't sleep. Frustrated, bewildered. And Then I got up and went back to the kitchen and I started warming some coffee, thinking that coffee would give me a little relief. And then I started thinking about many things. I pulled back on the theology and philosophy that I had just studied in the universities, trying to give philosophical and theological reasons for the existence and the reality of sin and evil. But the answer didn't quite come there. I sat there and thought about a beautiful little daughter who had just been born about a month earlier. We have four children now, but we only had one then. She was the darling of my life. I'd come in night after night and see that little gentle smile. And I sat at that table thinking about that little girl and thinking about the fact that she could be taken away from any minute. And I started thinking about a dedicated, devoted, and loyal wife who was over there asleep. She could be taken from me, I could be taken from her. And I got to the point that I couldn't take it any longer. I was weak. And something said to me, "You can't call on Daddy now. He's up in Atlanta, 175 miles away. You can't even call on Mama now. You got to call on that something and that person that your daddy used to tell you about. That power that can make a way out of no way." And I discovered then that religion had to become real to me and I had to know God for myself. And I bowed down over that cup of coffee. I never will forget it. Oh, yes, I prayed a prayer. And I prayed out loud that night. Lord, I'm down here trying to do what's right.
I climbed up to the highest mountain, looked all around, couldn't find nobody.
Lord, I must confess that I'm weak now, I'm faltering.
Went down into the deepest valley, looked all around, down there, couldn't find nobody.
Could hear an inner voice saying,
I went across the deep blue sea.
Stand up for righteousness.
To come here, to your grace, your
stand
love,
up
your
for
mercy.
Justice.
Nobody
stand
greater,
up for truth.
Nobody greater than
and
me.
Lord, I will be with you even until the end of the world.
Searched
all
over.
I've seen the lightning.
Couldn't find nobody.
I've heard the thunder.
I looked high and low.
I felt sin breakers dashing, trying to conquer my soul. But
nobody
I heard the voice
greater.
Of Jesus.
Say,
nobody greater than you. Nobody greater than you.
To leave me. Never to leave me alone. No, never alone.
Searched
no,
all
never
all
alone.
Couldn't find no
never believe me.
I looked high
never
and
believe
low.
Me alone.
Still couldn't find nobody.
I
nobody
feel
great.
I don't mind telling
nobody
you this morning. Sometimes I feel
nobody this greater than you.
I felt discouraged in Chicago.
Nobody
I moved through
heal.
Mississippi and Georgia and Alabama.
Like
I feel discouraged.
Almost
living every day under the threat of death, I feel discouraged sometimes. Living every day under extensive criticism, even from Negroes, I feel discouraged sometimes.
You are he who carried out redemption's plan.
Nobody
greater, Jesus.
God bless you.
Nobody greater than you.
searched all over.
Searched all over.
Couldn't find no.
Couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low. Still couldn't find nobody.
Nobody great. Body great.
Nobody greater than you.
Come on, lift those hands for real in here. Come on. Nobody greater. Nobody greater, Jesus.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Now lift those hands, singers, and let's just give him the glory. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Couldn't find nobody.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater than you.
I dare you lift your hands and say that with us tonight. Come on. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Body greater.
Nobody greater.
Body greater than you.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody like you, Jesus. Nobody greater. Say, nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
No matter where you look or where you
nobody
go.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Angels bow before you. Heaven and earth adore you. Nobody.
Nobody greater.
We came to lift you up.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Come on, everybody in the building singing. Nobody greater.
Hallelujah. We're giving God praise this afternoon. We're giving God praise for freedom. Hallelujah. This is Brother Andrew Edwards with the Prophetic Dimension. And today is Martin Luther King birthday. Martin Luther King Day. Glory to God. And we give God thanks for all that he's doing and continuing to do. He's giving us freedom. He's giving us prosperity. He's given us health and wealth. Hallelujah. And today, we're rightfully honoring Jesus above everything. And then secondly, today, Martin Luther King Day. Hallelujah. We give God thanks. It's a joy, it's an honor to do this broadcast today. And I was just tapped into a little of the history of Martin Luther King. He was a civil rights leader. He was, first of all, a servant of God. He was a pastor, and thus through his leadership as a pastor, it propelled him to a movement called the Civil Rights Movement. And for thus a cause, he was a martyr that paved the way for many of us today. So we rightfully give him honor on this day, and we thank God for him. For much of what we enjoy now, the liberties, are owed unto him for his sacrifice. So we thank God for Martin Luther King. And we're going to continue to praise God and enjoy the day. It's a beautiful day. I do so say myself. And I'm enjoying it, and I thank God for his blessing. Hallelujah. Stay with us, Prophetic Dimension.
And worship for who you are. granted favor,
and your compassion fail us not.
For they are new every morning.
Great is
thy faithfulness, Lord, please hear me.
Standeth God within the shadows, keeping watch above his own.
Yeah.
William Cullen Bryant is right. Truth crushed the earth will rise again. The Bible is right. You shall reap what you sow.
Now let me proclaim here and now that I am still convinced that the philosophy and practice of nonviolence the more excellent way to improve the inadequacies existing in the American social system. The method of nonviolent resistance is effective in that it has a way of disarming the opponent It exposes his moral defenses, it weakens his morale, and at the same time, it works on his conscience. I believe we will win it because the goal of America is freedom. Used and scorned though we may be, our destiny is tied up with the destiny of America. It is time to reorder our national priorities. All those who now speak of goodwill and who praise the work of such groups as the President's Commission now have the gravest responsibility to stand up and act for the social changes that are necessary to conquer racism in America. If we as a society fail, I fear that we will learn very shortly that racism is a sickness unto death.
Most holy Lord, you have my attention. And all my intentions, I want to honor you in every way. And I pour my love on you. My whole life belongs to you. I worship
the drum major instinct. Drum major instinct. And our text for the morning is taken from a very familiar passage in the 10th chapter as recorded by St. Mark, beginning with the 35th verse of that chapter. We read these words: "And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came unto him, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we shall desire. And he said unto them, What would ye that I should do for you? And they said unto him, Grant unto us that we may sit, one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy glory. But Jesus said unto them, Ye know not what ye ask. Can ye drink of the cup that I drink of and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said unto him, We can. And Jesus said unto them, Ye shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of, and with the baptism that I am baptized, withal shall ye be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared." And then Jesus goes on toward the end of that passage to say, "But so shall it not be among you, but whosoever will be great among you shall be your servant, and whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all."
My devotion,
and with all
my mind,
that day when Jesus would reign supreme as this new king of Israel. They were saying, now, when you establish your kingdom, let one of us sit on the right hand and the other on the left hand of your throne. Now, very quickly, we would automatically condemn James and John, and we would say they were selfish. Why would they make such a selfish request? But before we condemn them too quickly, let us look calmly and honestly at ourselves, and we will discover that we too have those same basic desires for recognition, for importance, that same desire for attention, that same desire to be first. Of course, the other disciples got mad with James and John, and you could understand why, but you must understand that we have some of the same James and John quality.
My whole life belongs to you. I worship you completely.
A desire to be out front. A desire to lead the parade. A desire to be first. It is something that runs the whole gamut of life. So before we condemn them, let us see that we all have the drum major instinct. We all want to be important, to surpass others, to achieve distinction, to lead the parade. Attention. This desire for distinction is the basic impulse, the basic drive of human life, this drum major instinct. And you know, we begin early to ask life to put us first. Our first cry as a baby was a bid for attention. And all through childhood, the drum major impulse or instinct is a major obsession. Children ask life to grant them first place. They are a little bundle of ego. They have innately the drum major instinct. Now, in adult life, we still have it, and we really never get by it. We like to do something good, and you know, we like to be praised for it. Now, if you don't believe that, you just go on living life, and you will discover very soon that you like to be praised. Everybody likes it, as a matter of fact. And somehow this warm glow we feel when we are praised or when our name is in print is something of the vitamin A to our ego. Nobody is unhappy when they are praised, even if they know they don't deserve it, and even if they don't believe it. The only unhappy people about praise is when that praise is going too much towards somebody else. But everybody likes to be praised because of this real drum major instinct. Do you know that a lot of the race problem grows out of the drum major instinct? Need some people have to feel superior, a need that some people have to feel that they are first and to feel that their white skin ordained them to be free. They have said over and over again, in ways that we see with our own eyes. In fact, not too long ago, a man down in Mississippi said that God was a charter member of the White Citizens Council. Not only does this thing go into the racial struggle, it goes into the struggle between nations. And I would submit to you this morning that what is wrong in the world today is that the nations of the world are engaged in a bitter, colossal contest for supremacy. And if some doesn't happen to stop this trend, I'm sorely afraid that we won't be here to talk about Jesus Christ and about God and about brotherhood too many more years. If somebody doesn't bring an end to this suicidal thrust that we see in the world today, none of us are going to be around, because somebody's going to make the mistake through our senseless blunderings of dropping a nuclear bomb somewhere, and then another one is going to drop. And don't let anybody fool you. This can happen within a matter of seconds. They have 20 megaton bombs in Russia right now that can destroy a city as big as New York in 3 seconds, with everybody wiped away and every building. And we can do the same thing to Russia and China. But this is why we are drifted, and we are drifting there. Because nations are caught up with the drum major instinct. I must be first. I must be supreme. Our nation must rule the world. I am sad to say that the nation in which we live is the supreme culprit. And I'm going to continue to say it to America, because I love this country too much to see the drift that it has taken. God didn't call America to do what she's doing in the world now.
Hallelujah.
God didn't call America to engage in a senseless, unjust war as the war in Vietnam. And we are criminals in that war. We've committed more war crimes almost than any nation in the world. And I'm going to continue to say it. And we won't stop it because of our pride and our arrogance as a nation. But God has a way of even putting nations. God that I worship has a way of saying, don't play with me. Has a way of saying, the God of the Old Testament used to say, the Hebrews, don't play with me. Don't play with me, Babylon. Be still and know that I'm God. And if you don't stop your reckless course, I'll rise up and break the backbone of your power. And that can happen to America. Yes. Every now and then I go back and read Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. And when I come and look at America, I say to myself, the parallels are frightening. We have perverted the drum major instinct. But let me rush on to my conclusion, because I want you to see what Jesus was really saying. What was the answer that Jesus gave these men? It's very interesting. One would have thought that Jesus would have condemned them. One would have thought that Jesus would have said, you are out of your place. You are selfish. Why would you raise such a question? But that isn't what Jesus did. He did something altogether different. He said in substance, "Oh, I see. You want to be first? You want to be great? You want to be important? You want to be significant? Well, you ought to be. If you're going to be my disciple, you must be." But he reordered priorities. And he said, "Yes, don't give up this instinct. It's a good instinct if you use it right. It's a good instinct if you don't distort it and pervert it. Don't give it up. Keep feeling the need for being important. Keep feeling the need for being first. But I want you to be first in love. I want you to be first in moral excellence. I want you to be first in generosity. That is what I want you to do." He transformed the situation by giving a new definition of greatness. And you know how he said it? He said, "Now, brethren, I can't give you greatness. And really, I can't make you first." This is what Jesus said to James and John. "You must earn it. True greatness comes not by favoritism, but by fitness. The right hand and the left are not mine to give. They belong to those who are prepared." So Jesus gave us a new norm of greatness. If you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be recognized, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But recognize that he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's a new definition of greatness. This morning, the thing that I like about you, by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great. Because everybody can serve. Every now and then, I guess we all think realistically about that day when we will be victimized with what is life's final common denominator. That's something we call death. We all think about it, and every now and then I think about my own death, and I think about my own funeral, and I don't think of it in a morbid sense. And every now and then I ask myself, what is it I would want to say when I leave the word to you this morning? If any of you are around when I have to meet my day, I don't want alone. And if you get somebody to deliver the eulogy, tell them not to talk. Every now and then I wonder what I want them to say. Tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That isn't it. Tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. Tell them not to mention where I went to school. I'd like somebody to mention that day Martin Luther King Jr. tried to give his life serving others. Like for somebody to say that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want you to say that day that I tried to be right on the walk. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try to feed the hungry. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try in my life. I want you to say on that day that I did try in my life to visit those who were in prison. I want you to say that I tried to love and serve humanity. Yes, if you want to say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice. Say that I was a drum major for peace. I was a drum major for righteousness. And all of the other shallow things will not matter. I won't have any money to leave behind. I won't have the fine and luxurious things of life to leave behind, but I just want to leave a committed life behind. And that's all I want to say. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word of song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a Christian, or if I can bring salvation to a world once wrought, if I can spread the message as the master taught, then my living will not be in vain. Yes, Jesus, I want to be on your right or your left side. Not for any selfish reason. I want to be on your right or your left side. Not in terms of some political kingdom or ambition, but I just want to be there in love and in justice and in truth.
Hallelujah. We give God thanks. Prophetic dimension, Brother Andrew Edwards, and we're on Martin Luther King Day, celebrating civil rights, freedom. Freedom not only physical, but spiritual. Through the Lord Jesus Christ and his servants who serve him in spirit and in truth, and who recognize that injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. Hallelujah. We give God thanks for his bountiful blessings. The time is winding down and it's a beautiful day outside, the first month of the year, the 20th day this Monday. And we are on our way. The month is coming to an end in another 11 days. And we just give God thanks because we are in the land of the living. We have health and strength and we are free. Hallelujah. Another day to get it right. Another day to say, Lord, I want to be better than I was yesterday. Hallelujah. Give me a new mind. Renew my mind. Give me a clean hand and a pure heart. Hallelujah. Remove every stubble, every mountain out of my way, Lord. Show me the right way to go. I renounce every false way. I follow your way. Hallelujah. We give God thanks. And you know, the Lord has impressed upon me to go fasting every 15 days out of the month. And if you should do so, I'd implore you also to do that. And the Lord has given me a scripture, Ezra 8, 21 to 23, that we must fast and pray and search for a right way for ourselves and our little ones. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We give God thanks. And when you get some time, read also Psalm 119. Hallelujah. Reject every false way. He's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Glory to God. And we give God thanks. And we give God praise. That was the drum major instinct from Martin Luther King. Hallelujah. A lot of us know the civil rights speeches, but a lot of us don't know that before he was a civil rights activist, he was a preacher. He was a man of God. Glory to God. He was a man of God, as you rightfully heard just now in his sermon. Thank God for that man of God that saw the problem and brought the solution. Nonviolence. Hallelujah. I tell you, there is power in nonviolence. There's power in silence. There is power when we don't take up arms and fight the battle is the Lord's. Glory to God. You know, he was way before my time, but I tell you this, he left an impact on me personally. And for a period of time as a youth growing up, I did not understand really the whole significance of it. But as an adult, you know, I really understand it now. I mean, literally understand it. When it comes down to economic issues and social issues and geographic issues, I really understand what this man did for me. personally, and also my children and my generations to come. So I implore you, if you don't know about Martin Luther King, just do some research, you know, Google it, do something, you know, teach the kids coming up. You may not have any use for it, but at least for the children to come, the children of promise, the children of the prophetic, that you so desire them to be good, productive citizens. Let them understand the price that was paid, that paved the way for many of us here today. This is Brother Andrew Edwards, and this is the Prophetic Dimension. And we're winding up right now, and we're just giving God thanks. And we're going to close out with a word of prayer. You can check us on Google Plus, Andrew Edwards. Drop a line. We're doing so many things you can see on the page. Also, you know, we're deeply rooted in prayer and fasting. This ministry is deeply rooted in prayer and fasting. You know, we play music and we preach a little, but make no mistake. This prayer, this ministry, pardon me, is deeply rooted in prayer and fasting. We cannot do what we do without the Lord Jesus Christ. Not by our might, not by our strength, but by his spirit. Thus saith the Lord. We continue to hold up the banner high here on Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. And we are praying continually, if need be, round the clock. Hallelujah. But until that time, we're going to continue to be obedient to the Lord and continue to carry this banner high. You know, and we cannot wait for any man to lead us. We got to look to Jesus to lead us and lead us by his footsteps and by his hand. Hallelujah. We thank God for his presence. We thank God for his love. We thank God for his kindness. We thank God that he spared us one more day. Father, I thank you for this broadcast. I thank you for the great man Martin Luther King, who for a short time on this earth made a difference. Hallelujah. We give thanks, God, for this medium. We give thanks, God, for your people. In spite of all the difficulties and all the things that may be wrong, there are still some things that are right. Hallelujah. We thank God for health and strength, and for family that cares for us and loves us. Hallelujah. Extend it unto our church family, and also to those in the body of Christ who are laboring in the harvest, oh God, and laboring to see souls won for God. Hallelujah. We thank God for every ministry, for every outlet, every track that is given unto those that are lost in the highways and in the byways, in the subways, on the buses, on the trains. Hallelujah. Over the airwaves and over the TV. Hallelujah. Those in missions, Father, we just pray that you protect them. Cover them with your Holy Spirit. Cover them, Lord, and bring them back safely to the fold. Hallelujah. We are gearing up, oh God, and we're preparing ourselves for these end times. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Check us again on Google Plus, Andrew Edwards. This is Prophetic Dimension, Brother Andrew Edwards. And I'm thank God for this outlet, Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. And greetings unto the Foster family. Happy New Year. Greetings to those in Canada and England and Jamaica, and all those throughout the world who are tuning in by internet, and the whole of the New York City, the Big Apple. We are praying and we are fasting for God to do a new thing, a shaking and awakening in our spirit. Send revival, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Let us look calmly and honestly. Let us look calmly and honestly. Let us look calmly and honestly at ourselves, and we will discover that we too have those same basic desires for recognition, for importance, that same desire for attention, that same desire to be first.
Even though he's in heaven, he's like a friend to me.
Friend to me.
He was a peaceful man, he told us love her enemy.
Enemy.
The man's name was Martin Luther King.
King.
But his only goal was to let freedom ring.
Ring.
He changed the world, probably even made it spin.
Spin.
He hated being judged by the color of his skin.
Skin.
He was a godly man, he probably hardly ever sinned.
Sin.
And you can search the world, you'll probably find no one like him.
Him.
He spoke the truth. And he was never wrong. Sometimes it's hard to think about King being gone. He's inspirational, present, and the past. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last. He used his words, never used
violence.
When he stepped in the church, all you heard was silence. He was a brave man, never was a coward. Never used his weapon, his words had the power.
Yes, if you wanna say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice, a drum major for righteousness. All of the other shallow things will not matter. Yes, if you want to say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice, a drum major for righteousness. And all of the other shallow things will not matter.
I had a dream that I would always live to see the dream of a king and hear that freedom ring from the highest mountaintop to the lowest of the scene. Everything so serene thanks to Martin Luther King. Fought for my rights, never had to intervene, never had to come between a life in the streets. As I walk through the door of justice and truth, I recognize what he did and how he saved the youth. But I still go on wondering how he did it all. Never thought about the dream and how he would ever fall. Once again, thanks a lot to Dr. King for everything he saw and everything he seen. The man is right, never used violence to fight. Swag so tight, look at what he did for the civil rights. And they wonder why I go and pray at night. Because of this man, the world is like a place of light.
Yes, if you wanna say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice, a drum major for righteousness, and all of the other shallow things will not matter. Yes, if you wanna say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice, a drum major for righteousness, and all of the other shallow things will not matter.
Wake up in this early morning, happy as a brand new day. Thankful for the chances God's grown. All because this man who saved me fought to break the chains that contain me, freedom to be what I can't be.
Life's a parade that we all want to lead. The drum major instinct is what King believes. It's like wanting to be first and not being next. That can make a fellow man something that you detest. People don't economize, they live above their means, cause they live in contrary of the King's dreams. The way to gain praise and to really stand out to serve others, that's what it's all about.
Yes, if you wanna say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice, a drum major for righteousness, and all of the other shallow things will not matter. Yes, if you wanna say that I was a drum major,